expand.
It's like a weird blank.
No, because I don't understand like guys who like, because girls sometimes they just go to the dance and the end of shopping. But like, what about guys?
I go very rarely to shopping. Like, if I know I need something, it's like actually shopping.
Okay.
It's like, I need these three things and then I'll go. But sometimes I buy more, I mean, it's very good. I mean, for clothes, especially, I go shopping.
Try to also fix this microphone, but I can't. There's something bad is that don't charge, and I don't know really why it's like that. But I'll remind them again. So, as usual, people want to go through the slides. I think we can go through at least the slides, more the theoretical slides, but maybe not so much about the human evolution, but they're kind of better explained when they need TED talk and that seems. That's okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's, I think, is more of the relevant. So, of course, I mean, the whole concept of tree is something I think everyone has seen, because you always have the idea of like, most of our life, so the idea of something's evolved. But I guess the fundamental point I want to make here is that it's really this type of tree is rarely actually the data we have. Actually, it's rarely we know exactly what the common ancestor is. I mean, it's more like the have things like that. We don't really know how things relate to each other. I mean, because of course, the common ancestor is something exists. And that is valid for both for sequences or animals or genes, whatever we look at it, we don't really know what the base was. So often what you need to do is often you have to define something like what's called outgroups, or something that you know is farther away from everything else, and then assume you have a common ancestor between that group and the type of genes or type of species you study. But it's not obvious in many cases exactly where the common ancestors should be, or the root of the tree should be. It should be there, or there, or there, or even there. It could be somewhere in this tree here. You know, just because this is somewhere in the center, doesn't mean that the common ancestor was here. It was maybe something happened here that made this evolve very fast. Maybe it was something up here that was the whole thing, and then something happened and this evolved very fast. So it's often actually the data have is more like that, but this is much nicer representation. And another point I want to make is that ideally, these branch legs here actually should mean a distance, or mean some kind of time frame, or evolution, or a number of mutations, whatever you want to call it. So, and of course, in a tree like this, you can draw it like that. I mean, if you have a measure, it might be correct or incorrect, but you could make a distance. So you can see that this one, this is this medium 3 feet, small 3 feet is 2 plus 1 unit, whatever. And then there was one other unit down here, and there was 1 unit here, and there was 3 units here. So there's a reason why this branch here is actually longer than this branch here, because from the model I have, it has been more mutations, or longer time, or more changes, however you measure that. So that is kind of the things that are not obvious from looking at the tree, that you try to depict in the tree. But there are types of things that are, so we have three like this. First thing you see, there is some kind of outgroup here, so it's not a type of birds, whatever. Maybe it's a dinosaur over there. This is the birds. So this birds, then you can figure that this is the road here. But if the branch length means something, this means that these ones are much closer to each other than these two, are, for instance, and it was maybe quite a storm before these branched away from each other compared to their time. However, if you really want to measure the distances, distance in this case is often some type of relation to number of mutations. So if there are genes, number of mutations per 2,000 base pairs, whatever. But if you have a tree like this, which is probably much more common, because we know that all these species, if you have a tree like this, then actually this tree, you can not really infer time in a way. Because this would, of course, if normally you somehow infer time scale over here. But this tree doesn't, this is just the tree that actually shows the number of mutations and not the time scale. And the reason could be because there are faster mutations here or more. There's a noise also. And so this one has been more faster. It could be that there could be one. Time is the same, but it's just accepting the limitations.
Isn't the only way to estimate the time by having some kind of global mutation rate, so it's kind of the same?
Often, you have, but there's no real way to estimate time directly from mutations. Batteries. And, that's right. So there is no real way to estimate. Time directly from mutations. So what you need to have, you need to have some reference point. You need to have some kind of estimate.
And then of course, then of course you also have to assume that the mutation rate is constant. So there has been, for instance, when people started HIV, which is like GP120 has extremely fast mutation rates. So even within the same in the body of an infected person, you have huge variation in the number of GP120s because they are mutating on time. But if you would assume a linear rate, then you would assume that this HIV is very, very new. Because if you do that, you will survive. So that was some of the theories that people used to say, it was created by the American army or something, or some experiments, whatever. But it was the reason because some parts of this deep threat has very high mutation rate, and some other parts have much lower mutation rate. So, yes, the assumption that everything evolves the same makes your clock completely wrong. But you can find some parts of this, some means that you assume it's a quite constant rate, and then you have. You know, maybe from fossil evidence that the bears and the pandas separated 20 million years ago. So then you could assume that we have some points here, then I can calculate the rest. But basically, you cannot do it because there are two things. One is that the number of errors you do in DNA, and of course, then the number of assumptions you have. That are how many of these are surviving in the next generation? Or if you could take a non-coding region, maybe you could do it. That's probably most of them are surviving at equal rate. But then you have generation times, and that can also change during time. And also you have effects about the population size. If you have a very small population, of course, everything looks much more similar. The big population, that some parts can evolve more differently. So there are different parts like that, so the exact timing is difficult. And that's of course also why you make the tweet look like this. Because this is this is what we have now. And then we actually know that this lays on perfect always. But if you have some data that maybe looks like that. But if you have a tree that is perfect on time, you should look for that. Then you can have it like this. You can even have time, yeah. But then you and that's of course what you would like to have, but that's not the case in most cases. So another sort of important distinction is the difference between species tree and gene tree. It's not really, the tree building is the same, it doesn't matter, the majority of the same matters. But we have this concept of octologs and paralogs, so basically genes that are obtained from duplications of the gene or genes that are related by speciation. So the idea is that if you have genes that are related by speciation, that they are, a gene in human, a gene in chimpanzee, most like that two things. But if you have duplications, you have like one GPCR and another GPCR, they can evolve different things because you still maintain the main one purpose is the other gene copy, it can be free to move to something else, but there can be some functional stages, one do more, it's more specified, the other less specified, and so on. So that is kind of a. And the reason why these things are kind of important for speciation is that sometimes they confuse trees also. So ideally, you want to take both things into account. So this would be a species tree. But if you were to look at the genes in this case, you would see that they have one human gene and one chicken gene that are more similar to each other than the two human genes are to each other. And that is because in a common ancestor, this gene was duplicated, so you have two copies of it, and that happened before the separation of human chickens. So they are further away in time. And if you assume that the mutation rate is the same, so it happens, then it's a factor of time. So, basically, when you have three, if you want to describe it mathematically, what you have is this kind of these points that are important. And you can actually try test the tree, but you can keep the tree different from generated in different assumptions or different using some subset of data or something. And then you can see how many times do you observe the same split. So here in the case, we have a split between raccoon and I guess this is bear, it's a split. And you have a split between raccoon also and I guess not between the dog. And you have a split here between raccoon and bear, and a split between these common together with the dog. And the sea lion and the sea lion have a split together and so on. So you can repeat this many times, and this is what's called bootstrapping. So if you generate 100 trees by some change of parameters, or some subset of data, do I get how many times do I observe this split? And in this case, you observe 100 times 100, so that's a better reliable split. While in these cases, it's only half the cases. So in our cases, maybe the bear would have been more similar to the dog, and the raccoon would be the outlier. Or even the raccoon and the dog would be together. Because I mean, the differences are small, so it's a bit of randomness there. So you could represent this as a condensed tree, of course. So basically, you can basically, and we don't know how this relationship between these are. But it's certain that it's something here, because we condense it down there, so we have a tree that looks like this. So the idea is that to know that a tree will have a bootstrap value, and you should look at it and see about it, think about it, how much you can interpret it. Just see, a single tree, it doesn't really provide, it doesn't put any uncertainty in it. So this is the definitions of topology and paralogy. And these are also, as I said, there are are the important concepts, because it somehow tells you about genome evolution. There has to be, the idea has very long been that offloads are functionally separated. That's the similar, but parallels do not have to be. The experimental evidence for that is not extremely strong. It really depends on how you define function in different cases, but it is a good theory about it. So do you understand the difference between offloads and parallels? Yes. I mean, and there are, it's definition is easy. But so basically, you might want to understand the evolution of a gene, like something like this. You have like application events, and you have also speciation events. There are people that are trying to develop. If you have a set of genes from a set of species, how can you infer what happens when they think duplicate? And you also need to have losses of genes, because genes will disappear. And you try to turn around. And it's actually computationally very difficult to do it in a good way. And I'm not convinced really how much extra information about the function does. I mean, it really tells you. My computation is very nice and probably tells you something about the function, but in most cases, in a broad sense, all these genes do the same thing, but rarely involved in completely different stories, and there are also probably other events can affect it. So, as you based on that, here I have a specification, here I have a gene duplication event 2, here I have a gene duplication event 1. This is what you want to find. So then this is an example from hemoglobin. When you have one subunit of time, so hemoglobin, as you might know, have four subunits, but it's 2 alpha, 2 beta. And then there's I think one of the subunits is different in the infants or in the fetus than they are in the born human. So I think it's different there. So there are probably 3 subunits. But, and this is of course because you want to have more cooperative binding of oxygen. And in fetus you want to have invertive binding because you want to steal oxygen from the mother. Early before animal evolution, I think, or in the early animals, there was duplication. Before that, I guess we had most likely a tetramer with single types of globins. And then you had duplication in alpha beta chain. And from then you had, in all the animals that I know about, to have at least one alpha and one beta chain. So all of these are orthodox, and all pairs here are parallels. And the homologs are just everything. So there is a database that's called COG. So the idea to find functionally related clusters of proteins. I'm not sure either how well it works, because it can become quite messy. But the idea is basically that you take if you have a complete genome, you take a gene that's most similar, and if a gene is most similar to in one species to another species, and also that gene in that species also means more similar to that one. Then you find pairs of relationships, and you can find clusters of these, you can find clusters of autologous genes that should function related. I think this is lovely, but I'm sure really if it's so informative, because I think there are always exceptions, and sometimes the genes have been lost when you do other things, so it's not as clear as you would like to have it. And you think I said you have the gene loss. So for instance, if you have the gene here, so this is why it's important to think about it. So if you see this what happened, so you had a split of alpha beta, but in this gene, in this species, you only have beta, but in this species you have only alpha. And this is species 3. then basically you would not, if you had only these genes, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 genes, or you would not get the right tree, you would get a tree that looks like this instead. You would think that the beta B is more similar to C and D than it's actually to A. So that would mean you get the wrong species tree. If you just study the wrong pairs of genes, you might get wrong information about evolution. And there are many other factors can affect it. So that's one of many uncertainties. Often when you want to study evolution, you don't want to just look at a single gene. So this is just the one which you want to obtain, and obtain to do that. Another big problem, particularly bacteria, but bacteria species are really, really hard to define. There are some people that have, and there are some big bacteria databases of evolution of bacteria, but the problem is that there's a lot of what's called horizontal transfer. And the most obvious thing that are made out of genomes is all this antibiotic resistance. So basically you have phage, something that involves antibiotic resistance, and then that is transferred to very differently related species of bacteria. So if you would use that to determine speciation, the species, you would assume that Salmonella and the E. coli are the same thing, and they're completely different. This is just the most extreme example, but this has happened so many times through evolution history, and so many duplication, fusion, and things like that. It's really, really hard to trace bacteria species when you had to make new groups, but really to try that. It really depends on what you look at. I think there are some people trying to look at some core genes that is very concerned, but that even that is difficult. And there has to be a lot of discussion between lateral transfer between bacteria and eukaryotes, or even between the eukaryotes. And most likely that it's most likely at least very rare. It exists at all, you can discuss. So there are some examples that have been proposed and people have been saying that they are probably not correct. But at least, anyway, it's extremely rare. But what has happened clearly in a number of eukaryotic genomes, and probably bacteria also, is that there's a lot of whole genome applications, basically the genome has been copied twice. Or in some cases it's just a chromosome, sometimes it's only a chromosome. Basically something goes wrong in division of the cell and something gets to copy everything. So that is one reason why some plant genomes are extremely big. So basically, even during breeding, there has been like a selective advantage to so you don't do something if you have plus 20 genes. So and of course, if you copy it, then of course, after a while, many of the genes are going to disappear, or some will survive, and so on. So it's going to be, that was a complication of the trace ancestry. And of course, in the very early life, when eukaryotes was formed, there was a fusion of some bacteria, probably cyanobacteria, that was fused to become mitochondria. And that was probably some archaeal, except it had archaeal features of the other. So, I mean, the chloroplast also, of course, cyanobacteria was probably chloroplast, sorry. I don't know what was there. So there have been fusion events. And so most of them, the chloroplast and mitochondrial genes have moved back most to the nucleus, but there are about 100 left in the most chloroplast and bacteria. So yes.
If there are also some organisms like phylogenes or something which actually can take over the blasters of the organism which they eat, and some of their genes are like the organism which they consume in the food chain, their genes are integrated.
Okay.
Their nucleus genome, so they can use the plastids from their organism. Now, how would we find evolutionary relationship in such strange organisms?
We would be very confused.
Yes.
Is that you focus on some genes there. So most likely the genes are in some parts and not so common others. So hopefully you can exclude disease and don't start in something else. But so certainly there are many cases of things that make things complicated. I have no idea how you do these cases, but I'm sure if you don't do it correctly, you will have a lot of problems. So that, and maybe you stay in the family is okay. But there is a tree of life of eukaryotes pretty well established. That's not a big question mark in most cases. Even the fungi and so on. The fungi is not what's missing, but I think it's quite well established. Of course, we never know what that's. Well, as I said, all similarities of Waldi. So this is like my favorite example. I think I've talked about it several times. So this is serine proteases. So this is the active site of two serine proteases. And they are very similar. But if you look at the whole protein, that's very supposed that they are nothing at all similar at all. So this is just because you want to have proteases, you're going to have active site like that and then evolve twice, or at least twice. But in general, that's not the most frequent. If you see some value, that's no immune things but homologous. Yeah, so this is just one of a few things that was that people use in evolution, I mean, most evolution stuff is that you just try to think that are quite similar in sequences because it gets quite difficult to sort of sequence of them to take too much. But you have. So then you can see, right, if you change the codons or if you change the masses, of course, we know there are many cases when you change the third codon in a triplet, the amino acids don't have change. And at least to first approximation, I would assume that would mean that change is neutral. So there is probably some selection preference of some codon bias, but it's quite weak compared to amino acids. So if you count the number of synonymous to non-synonymous mutations, so you want to change amino acids and the ones you don't, you can actually see what is the selective pressure, so how much purification happens during on a particular gene. So there are even cases you can identify in some genes that have more changes of amino acids than they have changes of more mutations to change the amino acids than you would expect by chance. So you're going to adapt it, so they're trying to adapt something. And if you identify these genes, they often occur when something changes in the environment for an animal. So one of my friends studied the grizzly bears and polar bears, and some of the few genes could detect was the retina, photoreaction things in the back of the eye. Because of all the light conditions are very different if you are living in Alaska or in London or in Greenland. So then you can find the things. And you have things like if you have selection in some plants that are breeded, how do you find things that are selected for to have breed? Become bigger or become more colorful than we breed for. So you can identify key genes in this way. And the other thing you notice there is actually that quite a lot of it is surprising many mutations that are neutral. I don't really think this changes, what you say, the fitness. There are many mutations that are neither making the animal more fit, or making the organism more fit, so that it can have more offspring, or making it completely less fit. So the general trend nowadays is that people do believe that most of the animals, most of the mutations are not really affecting the organism so much. So it's a neutral word here. So beginning of the thought was extremely rare, so the selection was very strong and killed everything. But now it seems to be quite clear that the clear background changes that doesn't really matter. So and then sometimes why we use it as a clock, because like if the only be very few mutations on one really make the individual more fit, it will not have random that. But if you have a background like random mutation happens all the time, you can actually use it as a clock. That seems to be from the last, I mean, probably 40 years, some people have started realizing that more and more. The original papers from the 70s. So, yeah, so remember, what the RF was pretty interesting. We see when we look at the multiple sequence alignment, we see that some positions, you know, some genes are extremely well conserved. And also, of course, the histones and the hardware limitations at all. There's a huge variation between different types of genes. This is the most complicated part of this lecture. How to make it all. So basically, we can divide them into two groups. One is like the hydrogen tree. That is actually in principle. These are what is the changes that have happened assuming a tree. Then you can try different trees to find a tree that fits best to the data. So basically, both these methods possible in the maximum likelihood. At least, you know, implicitly assumes that you have a tree, and then you calculate, okay, what mutations, what is the minimum number of mutations, what is the minimum number of mutations that happens that can in this tree that can explain my data. I mean, the data is the variation in sequences. And maximum likelihood, you basically do the same thing, but you have probabilistic models that are much more complicated model, and also often you have to try cases with. You say, okay, what happens if I do a branch here, if I do a branch here, what happens there? You're going to keep on mutating with changes to it. So these methods are also quite slow to keep on going to do. So often you need to start with something like this, and a similar idea, but in the journey, I think what I was talking about, to basically the time to find three from some data. So, in neighbor joining, with these methods, what you do is that you start with some distance matrix. So, you measure distance, and normally, that would normally be number of mutations on some level. But that's what it would be. That's why this works quite well if you have very similar sequence, basically, a line of nucleotides, you have to count the nucleotides to change. But in principle, you can use any distance measure you want to use. You can use some number of taking amino acid levels or some impairment distance things, but you want to have some distance. And if you have a tree that exactly fits, that exactly generates it, so that you really can make a tree like that to reproduce the state and call that additive. So here you have A and D are 14. Units away from each other, and this is actually what you have. So A is here for 8, and you have to go all the way up here again, so 8 steps, and you're down there, you have 6 more steps, you have 14. At the same time, D and C are D to 9, you have 6 here, and then 7, 8, 9 steps out there. So if you have three, this is of course very rare, everything has to be perfect, but in a perfect model, everything is additive, and you have no, that's the way you should have it. And then the tree will end here. But even better would be if you have a perfect model effect off, so that all the mutations happen at the same time all the time. So you would have this tree here, and so it means that you have these summaries would end up in on a straight line. So basically you have exactly the same number of mutations per time unit here. So A and B are 2 away from each other. Both A and B are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 away from C, etc. So this is like a tree. So what if you have this matrix, it's supposed to get for each to be the tree.
It's
not the same matrix as you had before, this was different. So this is not the same. Alright, that distance that you couldn't make in a perfect tree with because it didn't fit. But in most cases you don't have something like that. So that's one way to do. Do two. This is an example from the book we used to use. So what you want to do often, of course, it basically as we do in Castle W, where we also have a guy who's talking together, but here we only have the alignment, we assume the line is correct, or the distance is correct. So you have, if you have A and D here, then there are only one unit away from each other, one mutation, whatever you measure. Then you will assume this is the two species that are closest. So you will generate a tree where you have A and D, and then a new node here in the tree that is one unit away, or half unit away, whatever. And then you calculate a new tree where you replace, take away, new distance measure, you take away A and D and replace it with V, and V, I guess, is the average distance that D has, A and D has to all other distances. To all other distances. And then you get, okay, what is the next closest node? Now it's V to E. It has unit of 2. Then you just make it feel that. Yeah, V to E has unit of 2. A and D has a unit of 1 distance, this is should have 2. And you make a new node W. And then you can get this is with W to everything else. And now you can see that B and F are closest to each other. So B and F hasn't changed, so they're the same as they were over here. And B and F are not close to W, so you have to make a new branch with three, not somewhere else. You make a B and F like that. And you make a node X. You calculate all the average distance again, and you see that W and X are not close to each other, which is distance of 6. And you add them together. And you create a Y distance, and you are finished. Finally, you have the LC also, you have access to that to the tree like that. So, in principle, when there are a few things. One thing was, if there are several distances that are more or less the same, it can be random which one to start with, and then you're going to get different. No, it's not obvious you're going to have the same result when you start with. So, you can start with different numbers, start with different orders. Of course, this distance is not perfect, there is a noise level there, so you can calculate it from. One, if you have, often you say, assume that you have 100 genes, and you can do it. You use 50 at a time to calculate this tree, and you have different numbers. So this is the way you get these bootstrap numbers. You have try different ways to analyze the trees. And then there are a lot of variations how you do this. In my exact I do this. The number of problems like the long branches are difficult to do and so on. But the idea of this here is rather similar to what we do when we do cluster W. But we never realign with everything.
Sorry, can you go through like
the
stack after you did A and D because
you've got
one distance
and then what next after that? Yeah.
Yeah, like why would you go B and
so A and D, so now what you do here is you take A, take A to which one was the next one I forgot. It was E. So here you have A to E is 2 and D to E is also 2. That means that the average distance of this V node here to E should be 2 also. So then it will be accepted there and you replace it with 2. And then when you guess that to B, you have A to B was 6 and D to B is also 6. So you get a 6 there also, that's right. So I think it should be the average in every case there also. So then you get the W there and you get E. And then you take the average distance of A, D, and E, but you don't find that because the next one is actually, the next thing you find, the closest one is actually, suppose it's 4 here between D and F. So it was closest one, if I remember correctly. And then you take that one. And then you have to say, okay, what is the average distance between B and F and A, D, E? And I think you end up with 6 or something like that. And then see how that is closer than the distance between C and W, which is 8. So then you end up with that, and finally you put C in there. And you can see what it did say that C is actually 8 away from everything else. So I think this is a perfect tree, actually, that works perfectly in this case, if I'm not. You can check. this is A to E, this is 2, 1, 2, this is 1. If you take from A to C, it should be distance of 8. That's 4x, yes, that's correct. And all other down is correct. And the B to E, for instance, B to E should be 6. So that's what we have to have 6. I think this is actually perfect. Tree with this perfect time, which is of course rare, it's very so nice. This every distance here, I think, is agrees with this distance with there. You get it? You could spend the whole course on different philosophy matters, and we do much more of this in the comparative economics course. And I don't know exactly what matters it is, but and so there's a lot of that about mathematics, but the idea here is just to get a concept out of it.
Just a small
question. Yes? DIG, the distance between I and J. What am I? Number two species here. And then it's a navy going half later. Yes, that's right. It's basically a similar example again, but you got this case, you don't do it in a. You don't do it in you do it in non rotor 3. I think it's the same example again. More or less the same numbers, but it's similar. It's slightly different than the interpretation, but the idea is very similar. So, partial mode, on the other hand, I'm going to go through much of the likelihood, which is too complicated. This will need to explain. So, partial mode is that if you have a tree, and you have a number of species, they have to be the gamma delta epsilon, and you have a number of positions. So, you need to discretize in your gene. So, assume that these are the only ones that vary, but the rest is always the same. You want to find when did this nucleotide change? What's the most likely place when it changed? So what you just do is that you take the tree and you go through this one, so assume this is 3. When you get another tree, you test this tree best. But if you assume this is, you have one tree, and alpha and the alpha is more similar, and gamma and beta and epsilon are one group over there. You can just see when did the thing change in my maximum likelihood way. No, my partial mode is right. Partial mode is just find the examples we have more chances. So in the first position here, you have T, C, T, T, C. And so this is T, C, T, T. Alpha, T, delta is T, gamma is T. So T, 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 C. Yeah. So that means that if you only want to make one change, assuming we really want to know what was over here, we will assume either it was a T here and it changed to C over here, or it was a C over here and changed to T over there. You have no idea which one, but it's less likely that you had a T here and changed twice to C here, or that you had a C here and changed to T. Anything else would be more than one change. So that would be an assumption that you would have the world change happens. You can go through every side. So for side 2, you have A, C, C, A, A, and of course, that now you need to have two changes. You have a change over here, or that's always going to happen because alpha and delta are different, so you're also going to change either there or there. But in this case, you can see the change also occurs in alpha. Why then you have to have one more change because you don't know which one was the root. And then you can go through them step by step, so you can take the next step. And at the end, you end up with something that can explain this tree. The data you have from these three with 9 changes. Then you could try another tree to say, okay, what happens if you move this gamma over here? How many changes were they done? So that's your worst tree. Or if I take this out, the beta over here. So can generate these trees to your house. That's one. Or I can give you what was the most likely sequence here. Here is maximum likelihood. You can say, I mean, I have a 52% chance. Now I know that a 50% chance that it's T here. Or C here. This is part of both cases. So you could actually get generate what happened in every position. Yes?
So after you have so many trees, which one you're going to do?
You're going to take the one and you're going to try to... You want to make all part. In this case, you don't want to do the tree. But you have too many species, many genes can't do it. But I mean, the idea is that the tree that has can be explained with fewer mutations is the best one. Basically, so if you even if five species, you can generate all possible trees without trying them. But of course, if you have 5,000, you can't do it. So then you have to use some algorithms, start one and then start changing and stuff like that. But and also, of course, depends on the number of changes you have, many columns. And of course, it might be many trees that are identical, but in principle, you can try a large number of trees to pick out the best ones.
So the best one in that way is like the least.
Yes, I mean that's the most parsimonious solution, but most meaning the most fewer changes. And then maximum likelihood has a similar idea, but you have probability in the situation instead of yes, no, and it gets computationally hard. But it's probably the best method to do it nowadays. So that work on like Mr. Bates is one that you can provide it big data. Well, then, most of the rest of the lecture, I guess, was like some evolutionary facts and something that you can go through very quick. And basically, most hypotheses today assume that early life was some kind of RNA. So, and of course, the reason is at least partly because that RNA is the only macromolecule that can sort of self-replicate, not catalyze. DNA cannot have a catalytic function, RNA has it, and the proteins are not able to self-replicate because you're not confident. So then of course somehow the RNA becomes some membrane lipid close cells, and then they move to RNA, then they have an RNA, you know, and sometimes very, very early in life when you get the DNA part of it. Exactly how that happened, nobody knows, but it's clear that my exception to some viruses that probably evolve much later, all life on Earth is DNA.
In those three major trees, in what part is virus considered?
In none. So there is also a big. Viruses are not often considered to be alive, we can discuss it, but they clearly are. Not in analytic groups, anyhow. So there will be, and they clearly are probably much more variation between viruses that are all gathered together. Because clearly we have RNA viruses that have RNA as the genome, and we have DNA viruses. And yes, I think they're both things that develop in RNA viruses. And I don't know if even in emerging groups there are very huge variations. And you have phages that are in bacteria, and sort of virus bacteria, so they are basically a certain piece of DNA. So this is the. The relationship between the current viruses and the rest of life is not well established. It's like it's almost like this whole separate kingdom of life, so that it's probably different from everything else. And of course, it sounds like it's not alive because you can't manage without something else. On the other hand, the viruses are quite big, they have a lot of genes, and the viruses to the paper last week actually said that viruses really communicate with other viruses. We can basically have communication signals between viruses that have different ways of infection. So to define if they're alive or not is more philosophical question than anything else. Because I know there was bacteria that can't live down without intercellular bacteria that is parasites that live inside other cells. Therefore, these are not able to live alone either. We are not able to live alone either because we couldn't live without all the bacteria in us, or vice versa. So that's it's more a philosophical question than really, but actually evolutionarily there are very different modes of them, and there are, but of course they're not going to be used for transferring information between others. So there are probably too much in the world. How early life started, people discuss it. This is how famous experiments in the 50s, because Miller already thought it might be possible just spontaneously generate some acids or there are some ideas, something that come from comments, etc. But nobody really knows that either. But what is clear is that you have three kingdoms of life. If you have plasma, viruses, that is. And what you call, I think we have it there. So you have what is called the last universal common ancestor. But Luca is the famous name. So Lucy is Luca. So that last universal common ancestor, that's really last ancestor to all life, because viruses that exists on Earth. And it was, and there are clearly how good life is to be known. It's a whole mix. So some parts, if you make it three, in some cases, it really looks like this. So the archaea is clearly more similar to the eukaryotes. And there are a few new archaea found just also in the last couple of years that have many features of eukaryotes that were not present. The man that were thought to be eukaryotic specific. Not nucleus, but in some other features, the cytoskeleton and things like that. But there are some other parts that probably are more similar to bacteria. So it's exactly what you define as actually with that, or it should be more similar together. It's a probably mix of many different things. It's not so easy to separate down one thing. But then, of course, basically, you can say that you have lots of animal fungi, lots of different bacteria, lots of different type of bacteria. And of course, our closest relatives, I said animals or the fungi. So that's why we use yeast in that. So, of course, you can think about it into experiments, compare fungi, compare to using whatever here, you have E. coli, it's a huge difference in evolution type. So, archaea, I think I mentioned it was discovered in the 70s. By Carl Gross and George Fox. And of course, people thought it was very archaea, they were found in very strange environments. But as I said in the earlier study, they're most likely, if anything, they're more similar to eukaryotes than to other bacteria. And then, of course, I had some thoughts, but I think actually probably some of the paper explains it much better than I can. But of course, there has been a lot, I mean, that's one of the, for me at least, one of the most interesting observations that have come from all these genome projects is really the human Neanderthal evolution. And it's quite clear, even when the human genome project started, it was not even clear to everyone what was the closest relative to humans. It was chimpanzee or gorilla, but it's very clear. If you're trying to see that the chimpanzees are much closer to us than the gorillas are. And it's clear that the gorilla is the outgroup. So you have chimpanzees and humans are more similar to each other than you have they're both more similar to the gorilla. And then you have some different types of chimpanzees and different types of gorillas. The bonobos, but they are quite similar, but not this genus thing, but they're quite separated by 1 million years. You can also look at, if you look at the variation between these groups, you know, it was much smaller groups. There are, I don't know how many, few thousand gorillas are in the world anymore, but not that many. And but they're genetically much more diverse than we are. So the human population has quite recent to be, because they're very similar to each other compared to chimpanzees and gorillas or compared to other animals. It means that we are quite recent species that evolved quite recently. So very small variation in comparison. And also, if you look at fossils, you find much fewer fossils of these than you find these. Probably, well, maybe there's just more of these bipedal apes. Or maybe it was more than that, but in fossilized, or there's been more variation. But it's very clear, there's a lot of these things that were spread all over the world and were all went extinct, except this one group of here that's been. And you can do things through the reporter. Lot of fossil studies, and of course you can look at the brain size to pick and the teeth change and got more upright and etc. etc. And you can, of course, you can even ask, as a listener, the unit variation. This is the chimpanzee gorillas, one of us. The chimpanzees is the gorillas over here, and this is the human variation. It's probably as much as the DNA. It's a much less variation. But you can, so if you study this, because you can't just conclude much, you can study fossils, you can also study variation. In one case, if you try to take native populations, so you try to take people who have not moved around too much, you take like the primates inhabit this part of the world, you look at the evolution of the difference. And one thing you see is that the variation within Africa is much bigger than the variation out of Africa. So if you take two random African people, they are about 4 or 5 times more different from each other than if you take two non-Africans. And it doesn't matter if you are from here or from here or from over there. Oh, yeah. They are all much more similar to each other than two random Africans. So that indicates also that humans have been living much longer in Africa than outside Africa. And so the idea was that something like a few hundred thousand years ago, about 200, maybe 300 thousand years ago, that when your model is correct, because now you have what you need, you have current mutations, and you can know that the current human state has evolved. And then it expanded quite rapidly over all of Africa, because you got fossil evidence and so on. And then something, maybe 8,000 years ago, we expanded out of Africa. And now, this is the interesting thing, because now, what you know now is that there were already humans living there. It was this Neanderthals. And most likely it's here, but that's mainly due to fossil evidence and other information. And of course, then what discovered by Santa Pablo was that everybody living outside Africa has 1-3% of Neanderthal DNA in their genomes. So, and because it's everybody outside, it's very likely that this interbreeding happened very early, just when we left Africa. Because we know that Neanderthals were basically living here in this area. We have no evidence that Neanderthals live in Asia, or at least in East Asia, or maybe in West Asia. But there are caves in the Middle East, area, there are caves for us, even the little. So that was probably most likely some interbreeding and a few small fraction of the babies born had one Neanderthal mother or father, but it was not 50%, it was 1-3% of the genome. It was survived into all everybody else. There was some evidence, there was some other expansion later there, but I don't know what that really. And we expanded down here to Papua New Guinea as well, quite quickly. And then very recently, this was one of the first one in the video. Is that it was quite clear that there was another interbreeding event over happening over here. And the reason is because they found a small bone in somewhere in Siberia, which is not small up here, in a cave in the Altamira Mountains. It's a small bone or a small picky finger of a young woman, I think. And that had an extremely well-conserved genome, So you could sleep in this state even better than the Neanderthals. I don't know anything else about this fossil farm. I had no idea that it was not I didn't know it was Neanderthal or human. I found it in the microserve in the secret. And it's clear that this is not Neanderthal and not modern human. You all see that in the mitochondrial DNA, you see it on the human genome DNA also. So it also what they call it the Nostalon. And then you compare that to all the populations all around the world, and mainly the native ones, not the Europeans that moved around, but and they found that in Papua New Guinea and Indonesia here, the population had like 7-8% of the DNA from that species. So the only possible explanation I have is not that you went up here, but that population is here, but it was just somewhere in this bottleneck here where it was intervening. And it was intervening that had an impact on the future. So it's only down here. The later Australians are more here, much later, they didn't have it. It's just some small tribes down there that have it. So then, of course, we expanded all over the world. And most likely, there were very many other disintegrating events. Quite likely in Africa, because there were most likely other, but we don't know. It's like that probably other cases also, and probably maybe not in Americas, because there were people that arrived there quite late. But the fossil finds are very rare. So you would need a very conserved fossil. And also in the warmer climate of Africa, it's less well conserved. So it's much easier to find good fossils in cold climates. So Siberia is perfect. So here is some kind of model that we have. Homo sapiens come up here later, but there's some interbreeding here in Antarctica and also in Northern. There's also this famous Homo florensis in Java. It's finally very pygmy human living in a small island, Java somewhere. That they don't think they manage to see it, so they don't continue to put it there. And it might be very late in Homo erectus, it has been very small, it might be something else. So there are a few fossil parts. Because there's some in China recently that are most likely are Homo erectus that have been living there quite late. But so there are probably many more things to find, but the number of good species is not that high. Right, this is Neanderthal, so of course we found the Neanderthal. And they basically look like us, so slightly shorter, slightly robuster, slightly stronger. And we of course killed them all, except that some of them managed to bring us. Yeah, this is the model base now you have. So this is kind of, I think, one of the most recent. So basically, have the modern humans, and everybody from South Africa has a couple of percent of the DNA from Neanderthals, and then the ones living here in Oceania has a big fraction of it also, and maybe some smaller fraction of the rest of the South Asia or East Asia also, but that's. That's not at all clear. Therefore, it was a small intermediate between the two. And there's probably something else from here later that we don't know about. And then when the estimates are euphoriation. Well, so this is what big. This is a very old idea of Homo evolutionary logistics with reading. And this is the idea that was first month, and this is probably the idea we have now. This is small intervention here in some region areas. And then I think the data is supported by concrete evidence. So there were also lots of more fine-grained immigration patterns where you can study, but it's very hard to trace back if you want to learn. And so there are questions like when farming comes to Europe. Was it adopted by the people that were living there already, or was it new people coming out and just outcompeting the people living earlier? I mean, there are different questions I can try to answer. But one of the famous anything those people studied, always the dogs, so people love dogs. So like, is the dog, when was the dog domesticized the first time? Was it in the area? And then sometimes it was in Asia, sometimes it was Europe, and it was mixed, and people had different ideas. And it's a long fight for many years to decide. Everybody wants to be the dog inventor. And I it's quite nice to have it several times. It's not such a one time event. But clearly, it's an important issue because people probably need to sign a paper every 2 years about it to have more data. And that's a. And it's probably most likely that it's difficult to see because dogs are so extremely bred. So I mean, you can only study some wild dogs, but the real dogs that my pet dogs are so strangely bred. So it's very hard to see the evolution of patterns in them. So they're completely, I mean, can be this small and this big and furry, not furry, and that. And then there's only 10,000 years. So there's only a few thousand generations. So they are not normal natural selection. Okay, was there some other questions? So we have hidden trees. So one of the things that always put on data is like this is what genome bioinformatics has changed. Before you had genomic information, you couldn't of course know you have all the data. I mean, but if you have a genome, you can be pretty sure you have everything there. So that really helps a lot. If you have paradox, you only have one gene for one species, it would be harder. But people often use this, using a gene that exists in every species and only one copy, so they have 16S RNA, I don't think that. I think most people only have one copy of it. Or there are histones, those kind of stuff. And you want to have a gene that evolves in the right speed. Right? Yeah. So long distance, long evolution times, so whatever, slow evolving gene, and the two things kind of fast evolving gene. But certainly, gene duplications and misdata is a problem. And trees are rarely perfect. I mean, look at these trees here. It's not, we also want to have a tree that is just one thing, but it is all the populations. It's never, it's not a single person who's the first human. It's of course, I think there has to be two, but most likely it's a group of people that breed one. The species cannot be a single person. I mean, bacteria can, but not the humans. So it's really a population, and the population can be quite small. I think there are estimates how big this initial population was, and it was maybe a few thousand individuals, but not one. But there will be millions, but you probably need at least a few hundred or something. So cellulose are, of course, extremely rare, and of course, the idea is that it should be not similar to at all. It's something even more random. But it's not a big deal, because most of the things kind of homogeneous. So it's not a term that is used. And it's not that you really study because you can't really do much about it. I mean, it can be interesting to study for understanding from a physical chemical point of view how you can do chemical reactions of that, but not from an evolution point of view. Did Cox explain anything? Why B and C is three and this matrices? So, I mean, maybe your UPMA are similar, methods is not exactly identical. It's just something exactly how to normalize the distances are different. And I mean, I don't remember exactly, but basically, they're very similar idea. And personally, of course, you also have two short choices, but you can't choose them randomly. Two choices to do one time. This number of changes can be the same, so it doesn't really matter. Okay. So, what do you think happened to all the others to have given up?
I saw a lot of people in
hyperlapse. They didn't think that That's more important, okay?
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's well, we'll see what happens in the exam though. I mean, we should only put the classes on the pipes and think so. That's not fair. No, I said that not only classes for programming. That's an absolute lapse, and that's another story.
I think the problem is that Python is really hard to do, so we need to spend a lot of time on it.
Yeah, but you can go here 1 hour, it's probably a good break.
But the problem is that while you're working with one Python exercise, then suddenly you get another Python exercise, and then you get a lab exercise as well, and things just keep increasing.
But most people are done with the exercises.
I don't know.
I think most people are done. Not with all, but I have it somewhere. And you have to hide the names. This is. I mean, should we add. Should we want to see each other's names? You can. So the first one's the 40 people down, maybe the first lab is 30, 34. Yeah, I didn't know, but this Python is only V yet. And this is Python 4, Python 3, but this has to be for that. And Python 2, everybody except 5. So it's not that look that bad.
But we still have stuff to do, and we have to turn it, especially Python, we have to turn it in before 72 hours. Or you start getting
biased. And you lose 0.2 points on the exam. So I'm pretty sure that sitting here 1 hour will teach you more than 0.2 points in the exam. So I think it's untactical studying. But even though 0 points, if you lose 10 points in the exam, it's one question. And you can still. So that's, it's not really the major part. But it's really being one day late, it's not that big deal. And I think probably it's good to do something else for your brain. So go out from the earth and here for 1 hour and do something else. It probably helps you to do the time more faster also. But I shouldn't tell you because you're here. I should tell Dutch. But you can spread the word. Okay, see you tomorrow is Friday, isn't it? Tomorrow is Thursday. So see you tomorrow.
Tomorrow is 12 o'clock. Tomorrow is 12 o'clock. Yeah, because I have a meeting at 1:30.
No lunch.
Lunch after, before. Yeah.